الرحمن الرحيم وصلى الله على النبي الأمي برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. الحمد لله. Allah has given us tawfiq. We were just discussing the Hajj of Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam's return from Hajj. There's one Sahabi who we would be discussing today who narrates this amazing hadith. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لا تزال أمتي بخير ما عظموا هذه الحرمة حق تعظيمها. My ummah will remain in goodness as long as they respect the sanctuary and the sanctity of the Haram Sharif, of Makkah Mukarramah and of the Holy Lands. When my ummah will respect Makkah Mukarramah and the Haram, حق تعظيمها, how it should be respected, then they will remain in goodness and in Allah's protection. فَإِذَا ضَيَّعُوا ذَلِكَ هَلَكُوا. When the ummah will violate the respects and the sanctuary of the Haram, then definitely they would be destroyed. This Sahabi is none other than Ayyash bin Abi Rabi'ah al-Makhzumi radiyallahu anhu. This was that individual whom Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made dua for on so many occasions. Let's discuss his early Islam. He accepted Islam in the early Meccan stage. And he made a lot of sacrifice with the Muslims in the initial stages. Aslama qadiman, he was a Muslim. He made great sacrifices. But we learn from him embracing Islam, we learn that Allah is the giver of hidayah. Because let's study the family background of Hazrat Ayyash radiallahu anhu. His mother was Asma bint Mukharriba bin Jandal. So Asma bint Mukharriba was the mother of Hazrat Ayyash radiallahu anhu. But she was also the mother of Abu Jahl bin Hisham. So Ayyash radiallahu anhu and Abu Jahl shared the same mother. There was another Sahabi, Al-Harith radiallahu anhu. His mother was also Asma bint Mukharriba. So Hazrat Ayyash radiallahu anhu, Hazrat Harith bin Hisham radiallahu anhu and Abu Jahl shared the same mother. And interestingly, Abu Jahl and Hazrat Harith radiallahu anhu shared the same father as well. His name was Hisham bin Mughira. He was married to Asma bint Mukharriba. He then divorced her, and his brother Abu Rabi'ah bin Mughira wedded her, and from that wedlock came Ayyash radiallahu anhu. So their fathers were brothers, and they both shared the same mother, meaning all three of them. So Ayyash radiallahu anhu, despite having a brother like Abu Jahl, who from the inception hindered the path of Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but still Allah is the giver of hidayah. Those who were closest to Abu Jahl got hidayat. For example, his own son became one of the great Sahaba radiallahu anhu, Hazrat Ikrimah radiallahu anhu. His own daughter Jamila radiallahu anha. So Allah is the giver of hidayah. Let's learn this lesson from here. Who are you and me to judge? Invite everyone to Allah. Share the message of Allah's deen. Even if one is hostile, one is disrespectful, make dua for them and give them the message. Make the message of deen available to them and tear for them at night. Allah will give them hidayah, or Allah will bring their children to hidayah. Allah is the giver of hidayat. Even Abu Lahab, who used to harm the cause of Islam so much, Allah gave his children hidayat. This was the extent of the effort of Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And this is the vastness of the mercy of Allah. So who are you and I to say this one will never change? Allah forgive us for such utterances. Who are you and I to say such things? What was the condition of our forefathers when those bringing alive Sahaba's efforts radiallahu anhum came to our forefathers and took time to teach them lovingly, guide them, encourage them? So let us also play our part. Muhammad ibn Ishaq rahimahullah narrates from Hazrat ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, who narrates from his father Umar radiallahu anhu. Umar radiallahu anhu said that when myself, Ayyash radiallahu anhu and Hisham bin As radiallahu anhu, the three of us said to each other that let us all three make hijrah together. There were many others who joined them, but the agreement was between these three and whoever else wanted to join. And the three of them radiallahu anhum said that we would meet in an area called Tanadib. This is an area near Sarif, a famous area in history outside Makkah Mukarrama. And the deal was, whoever makes it there, we should carry on if the time elapses. Because it means that the other is captured and locked up by the mushrikeen of Makkah. Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu said, it was myself and Hazrat Ayyash radiallahu anhu who met there. And then we realized that Hisham was captured and trialed and forced to forsake his iman. Anyway, the two of us continued on our journey and we traveled together, Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu and Hazrat Ayyash radiallahu anhu. When we arrived in Medina Munawwara, we stayed in the area called Banu Amr bin Auf. This was in Quba. Then what happened was Abu Jahl bin Hisham and Harith bin Hisham both undertook the journey. And what was their sinister plan? To get their brother Ayyash back by any means possible. Now we all just learned how close was the relationship between Abu Jahl bin Hisham and Harith bin Hisham and Ayyash. Their fathers were brothers and they were brothers from the same mother. We just explained how. Now they come to Ayyash and they are convincing him that Ayyash, you have to come back. Umar radiallahu anhu is encouraging Ayyash, you remain firm. Now as they're speaking to Ayyash, the brothers tone, and then they said, they brought the mention of the mother. You know your mother Asma binti Mukharriba. Your mother has taken a vow that she would not even comb her hair or bathe or take shelter from the sun. She will remain suffering. She will remain suffering, staying outside until you return to her. She wants to see you. When Ayyash heard that this is the vow of his mother, Umar radiallahu anhu calls him one side. Umar says to him, oh my friend, oh my brother, don't be beguiled by them. They are trying to trick you so that you can forsake your iman. Be careful. Your iman is more important. Your iman comes first. Do not return with them. Do not forsake your iman. And then Umar radiallahu anhu tells him, you know what? If your mother is suffering, definitely she will comb, she will bathe, she will take shelter, she will make herself comfortable. But do not forsake your iman. Ayyash said, you know, it's my mother. I have to fulfill her qasam. And also, one time, I have wealth there. I'll bring my wealth along. But we learn one very important lesson here. Umar radiallahu anhu teaches us that Allah comes first. Yes, we love our parents, respect them, but always remember the order of Allah comes first. And see how important is iman. Anyway, Ayyash then says, I'll have to return to fulfill the vow of my mother. And also, in that, Umar, don't worry. I got wealth to stash somewhere in Makkah, I'll bring it. Umar radiallahu anhu says to him, look here, Ayyash, you know the extent of my wealth. Inni lamin aksari Qurayshin mala. I'm the wealthiest in Quraysh. Don't go back. My wealth, falaka nisfu mali. My life savings, I carried it. It's all here. I have so much. It's valued at so much. Half is yours. Don't go. Hazrat Ayyash radiallahu anhu felt for his mother and he departed. Umar radiallahu anhu then said to him, okay, if you have to go, then take my conveyance, my camel. It is very obedient, submissive and docile. Why? Because if you notice something doubtful regarding the two of them, you can escape on my camel very, very easily. This was the extent Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu was prepared to go through to save one person's iman. Allahu Akbar. Umar radiallahu anhu offered him half his wealth, his entire life savings, his earnings. Umar radiallahu anhu gives him his best conveyance. Let us learn a lesson from here, my respected listeners, my respected lovers of Sahaba radiallahu anhum. What sacrifice Sahaba radiallahu anhum made for iman, and how Sahaba were prepared to sacrifice so much to save one person's iman. What are you and I prepared to do to save another person's iman? Really, this is the time in the world where conditions are so pitiable. Masajid are empty. People are distanced from deen. People are yearning for that reminder about Allah. Let us save each other's iman. Let us work on each other's iman. Allah will bless us so much that Allah will protect our children's iman. Work on the youth of the ummah. Allah will protect our youth's iman. Work on the children of the ummah. Allah will protect our children's iman. Work on the iman of each other, because this is what we learn, that Sahaba radiallahu anhum did this. Allah give us tawfiq. So as Ayyash radiallahu anhu returned with his brothers and en route to Makkah, Abu Jahl then says to him, "Oh my brother, ya akhi, wallah, laqad istaghlaltu ba'iri hadha. My camel seems to be defiant. I see the camel you ride is very, very docile, obedient and comfortable. Afala tu'qibuni ala naqatika hadhi? Wouldn't you give me a ride with you on your conveyance?" He says, "Sure, brother, bala." He brings down his camel, he halts it, and he now allows his brother to climb on with him. And as he climbs on with his brother, the two of them, adawa alayhi fa'uthaqahu ribatan, they both pounced on him and tied him up. They then took him to Mecca and they tortured him. And they put him through trial and severity. He was locked up and he was tortured and he was put through so much that Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would make dua for him. And this is reported in hadith where Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would make qunut. Qanata Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would make qunut. Yad'u lil mustada'afina bi makkata. Making dua for those Muslims who are oppressed and forced to remain in Makkah Mukarramah against their wishes. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would make dua for all the Sahaba who are going through this turmoil in Makkah. He would make dua for them in general, that Allah Ta'ala open their way and alleviate their challenge and make it easy for them to make the hijrah. And Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would name certain Sahaba amongst them, and he would take the name of Ayyash bin Abi Rabi'a in his qunut. وَيُسَمِّي صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ مِنْهُمْ الْوَلِيدِ بْنَ الْوَلِيدِ وَسَلَمَةَ بْنَ هِشَامِ وَعِيَّاشِ بْنَ أَبِي رَبِيعَ. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would take the names of these Sahaba radiallahu anhum. So we learn that Sahaba went through so much in Makkah as well. He was put through so much of torture. One great Sahabi who would actually go to Makkah to rescue the Muslim prisoners, he was none other than Marthad bin Abi Marthad al-Ghanawi radiallahu anhu, a very great Sahabi. He would sneak into Mecca, untie the shackles, get Sahaba out of their imprisonment and help them out. At times they were so weak because of torture, he used to actually carry them. That was Marthad radiallahu anhu. Anyway, Ayyash radiallahu anhu went through lots of difficulty, but Umar radiallahu anhu would never forget his saatis. Umar radiallahu anhu says that we felt at that time, if someone was trialed and then he succumbed, Allah would not accept his tawbah. But when the verses of Quran were revealed, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expresses his mercy in the Quran Kareem, we learn from there that those who went through difficulty and they succumb, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will still forgive them and bless them and accept them. So when these verses of the Quran Kareem were revealed, in Surah Zumar, verses 53-55, after أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل يا عبادي الذين أسرفوا على أنفسهم لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله إن الله يغفر الذنوب جميعا إنه هو الغفور الرحيم وأنيبوا إلى ربكم وأسلموا له من قبل أن يأتيكم العذاب ثم لا تنصرون واتبعوا أحسن ما أنزل إليكم من ربكم واتبعوا ما أنزل إليكم من ربكم من قبل أن يأتيكم العذاب بغتة وأنتم لا تشعرون أن تقول نفس يا حسرة على ما فرطت في جنب الله وإن كنت لمن الساخرين. عمر رضي الله عنه wrote a letter to his saatis in مكة مكرمة. And in this letter, he quoted this verse of the Qur'an al-Kareem, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Tell them, O Nabi of Allah, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِي, O my servants, O my bando, O my servants, الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ, those who have transgressed upon their souls, those who have done wrong, never lose hope in the mercy of Allah. Allah forgives all sins, يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا, because He is oft forgiving, most merciful. وَأَنِيبُوا إِلَىٰ رَبِّكُمْ, and turn to your Lord, turn to your Rabb, turn to your Allah. وَأَسْلِمُوا لَهُ, submit to Him, give in to His command, abide by His rule, be true Muslim. وَأَسْلِمُوا لَهُ, submit to the order of Allah and connect to Him.
before the punishment of Allah comes. And when Allah's punishment comes, then you would not be protected and you would not be helped. And follow what Allah has revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the end of the verses. And then the verse actually says, let it not be too late that one protects his iman, that أَن تَقُولَ نَفْسٌ, where a soul, a time comes where a soul then says, يَا حَسْرَةَ عَلَى مَا فَرَّطْتُ فِي جَنْبِ اللَّهِ, oh how I regret because of my violating the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have to protect our iman. Otherwise, if we forsake our iman and lose our iman, then certainly when we die, it'll be too late then to change. We have the opportunity to change now. When Umar radiallahu anhu wrote this letter to his Sa'atis day in Makkah Mukarrama, Hisham bin Aas, now remember Hisham bin Aas, he was one of the three who were the friends who had the appointment to meet at Tanadub. He was actually the brother of Amr bin As radiallahu anhu. But Amr bin As radiallahu anhu became Muslim much later. So Hisham radiallahu anhu received this letter. And he said, when Umar radiallahu anhu's letter came to me, I would read this letter and I would ponder over it. And I would ask Allah, Allahumma fahimniha, O Allah, enable me to understand this letter. And Allah put the understanding in my heart. And I realized that these verses from Allah are revealed regarding people like us, wherein we thought that we are totally lost and there's no chance for us. But Allah is prepared to forgive us. And Allah is merciful and kind. Yes, we were trialed and we had gone through difficulty and we had went through that challenge and then we left the hijrah. But now Allah Ta'ala is giving us the chance. He said, I went straight to my conveyance and I directed myself to Medina Munawwara. This was the sacrifice of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. But see Umar radiallahu anhu's fikr and worry for one individual. This is what we learn. Every person is important. And no matter how much we can spend for one person's hidayat and iman also, it is valuable. It is a good deal. Because how great it is to sacrifice for our iman and for others' iman. And this is the legacy of Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Because the wealth we will spend will still perish or be used somewhere else. But when we spend that time and that wealth and our expertise and our position and we use it for the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we put it to value. There's an amazing report by Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, wherein he says, أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قنت في صلاة العتمة شهرا. Allah's Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم made قنوت, قنوت صلاة, قنوت دعاء, دعاء قنوت in عشاء صلاة for an entire month, making دعاء for all the Muslims who are suffering and taking the names of a few. اللهم أنجي الوليد بن الوليد, اللهم أنجي السلمة بن هشام, اللهم أنجي عياش بن أبي ربيعة, اللهم أنجي المستضعفين من المؤمنين. Oh Allah, you save all the Muslims who are suffering, who are going through torture and are remaining firm on your deen. Oh Allah, save and rescue Walid bin Walid, Salama bin Hisham, Ayyash bin Abi Rabi'ah radiallahu anhum. Walid bin Walid was Khalid radiallahu anhu's brother. He embraced Islam after the Battle of Badr, but he was also locked up by the Quraysh and he was put through torture to forsake his iman. Salama bin Hisham was also another great Sahabi who also made so much of sacrifice. He was also another brother of Abu Jahl and he was Khalid radiallahu anhu's uncle. And from the initial stages he remained firm on his deen. He went through sacrifices. He was put through torture, being such a senior person embracing Islam. And Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made so much of dua for him. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu says, then Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then stopped his dua. وَأَصْبَحَ ذَاتَ يَوْمٍ فَلَمْ يَدْعُوا لَهُمْ. He didn't make dua, qunut. So I went to him and I said, O Nabi of Allah, I see you didn't make dua today for them. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, O Abu Hurairah, أَوَمَا تَرَاهُمْ قَدِمُوا. Didn't you see them come? Didn't you see that Allah has rescued them and they arrived? And that also is quite interesting in history, where after the battle of Khandaq, alhamdulillah, Ayyash radiallahu anhu and Walid radiallahu anhu and Salama radiallahu anhu, they escaped and they left Makkah Mukarramah with the special help of Allah Ta'ala. The mushrikeen, the Meccans, sent Khalid radiallahu anhu on the chase, and they reach this area Usfan. Khalid arrives there. Allah Ta'ala covered their tracks and helped them, and they made it into Medina Munawwara without any difficulty because of the help of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. When Ummu Salama binti Hisham, meaning Salama bin Hisham's sister, when she got to know of the escape of her brother, she got so happy. She said, Allahumma rabbal ka'batil musallama azhir ala kulli aduwin salama lahu yadani fil umuril mubhama kaffun biha yu'ti wa kaffun mun'ima. O the Lord of the Kaaba, the protected Kaaba, you give Salama, my brother, victory over any enemy. So the sister is making dua for her brother, and then she says, Oh Allah, you have all the authority and you have all the ability to do amazing things in amazing ways, because you are most powerful, you are the one that gives and you are the one that grants. So she made dua for her brother. When Ayyash radiallahu anhu and Salama radiallahu anhu and all the Sahaba, when they arrived in Medina Munawwara, years had gone by where they felt that they came late to be in the company of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they had sacrificed more and were prepared to give more time to learn and strive for the deen of Allah Ta'ala, for the pleasure of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. In this verse of the Quran, in chapter Nahl, Mufassirin mentioned under this verse, ثُمَّ إِنَّ رَبَّكَ لِلَّذِينَ هَاجَرُوا مِن بَعْدِ مَا فُتِنُوا ثُمَّ جَاهَدُوا وَصَبَرُوا إِنَّ رَبَّكَ مِن بَعْدِهَا لَغَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Certainly your Lord, regarding those who made hijrah after they were put through trial, they were put through turmoil and trial, and they strove and sacrificed and patiently went through everything, and they still made hijrah in Allah's way, Allah is all forgiving and most merciful towards them. Tabari rahimahullah and other mufassirin mentioned that those who patiently protected their iman and who are alluded to in this verse are namely Salama bin Hisham and Ayyash radiallahu anhum and Walid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhum. As we mentioned, that other great Sahabi who actually used to go and rescue the captives amongst the Sahaba radiallahu anhum in Makkah Mukarramah, Marsad radiallahu anhum. On many occasions he would go. On one occasion something very interesting happened. He travels from Medina Munawwara and he comes into Makkah Mukarramah and he conceals himself, and he's about to get to the area where the Sahaba were kept in hostage and imprisonment. As he is about to arrive there, on this one occasion, there was this lady known as Anaq, and she was known to be someone loose, and Marsad radiallahu anhu knew her in his past, and he changed his life, he embraced Islam, he became the Sahabi of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and now Anaq sees him, so she calls him, come Marsad, bit indana layla, come, let's spend some time together, let's just spend one night. Marsad radiallahu anhu explains to her that I've changed my life, this out of wedlock is not permissible, I cannot do this. She got so upset, she went to the mushrikeen of Makkah and complained about Marsad, saying that this is what Marsad is doing. And they sent their men chasing Marsad radiallahu anhu, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved him. He escaped, and actually as he was running, he ran into a cave. And alhamdulillah, Allah ta'ala protected him. They didn't find him, and he then rescued some Sahaba radiallahu anhum and took them to Medina Munawwara. So we learn that yes, challenges do come in life in different forms, in different ways, but we have to protect our iman as Sahaba radiallahu anhum taught us. They changed their lives, they didn't return to the wrong, and they made tawbah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted them in the best of manners, as we see in the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Towards the end of this discussion of this Sahabi, Hazrat Ayyash radiallahu anhu, there's an amazing report from Abu Nu'aym, from Habib bin Abi Sabit radiallahu anhu, says these three Sahaba, Hazrat Haris bin Hisham radiallahu anhu, Hazrat Ikrimah radiallahu anhu, Hazrat Ayyash radiallahu anhu, were in Allah's way in Roman territories, striving in Allah's path, taking deen to humanity. It was the day of Yarmouk, and they were severely wounded. So as Haris radiallahu anhu is breathing his last, those on khidmah bring water for him. As he is about to drink the water, he hears a moan from someone next to him, and he sees Ikrimah.
He says, serve the water to him. As the water is brought to Ikrimah, Ikrimah radiallahu anhu sees Hazrat Ayyash radiallahu anhu. And as he says, serve it to my brother. And as they rush to serve it to Hazrat Ayyash radiallahu anhu, who was actually his uncle, Hazrat Ayyash radiallahu anhu breathes his last. Then they rush to the other two, and they also had already departed from this transitory world. This is Sahaba radiallahu anhu. In this world, in their lives, they served Allah, serving Allah, pleasing Allah, making khidmah of humanity, showing preference to others over themselves, and even as they left this world, they put others first. This is the qualities of Sahaba radiallahu anhu. Allah give us tawfiq. This is how great Sahaba radiallahu anhum are. Allah give us tawfiq to even make ikram of others and show ihsan and kindness and compassion to others. There's this other Sahabi who we should also learn about. Al-Bara bin Ma'rur radiallahu anhu. He was known for his love for the Kaaba. And we just now completed with Hajj. Allah give us tawfiq. See how Sahaba loved the Kaaba. He was amongst those Sahaba radiallahu anhum who embraced Islam in the initial Medinan stages, where Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would meet the people and invite them to Allah ta'ala. And as Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would invite the people to Allah, people would refute him and reject him. Then the youngsters from Medina, the Ansar, embraced. Among the first to embrace was Al-Bara bin Ma'rur radiallahu anhu. So the first Hajj. The second Hajj was the 12th year, where he's coming with his companions from Medina to meet Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it's reported by Ka'ab radiallahu anhu, who says that Bara radiallahu anhu on the way told us that, what do you all think about my idea? I know we're living in Medina, and at this time Muslims are facing Baytul Muqaddas, but I feel I should not face my back towards Kaaba. I want to face Kaaba as my Qibla. Anyway, the others said that, you know what, do what Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. So en route, when they stopped to perform salah as well, the other Sahaba radiallahu anhum faced Sham, Baytul Muqaddas, in their salah, and Al-Bara radiallahu anhu faced Al-Kaaba. When they arrived in Makkah Mukarrama during the days of Hajj, Al-Bara radiallahu anhu says to Ka'ab bin Malik radiallahu anhu, come, my brother, let's go meet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and ask him, what's this? Ask him about this matter that in my heart in regards to facing the Kaaba. And when they posed the question to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that this is the Qibla Allah Ta'ala gave us for now. Let's follow what Allah Ta'ala wants us to follow. The incident narrated by Ka'ab radiallahu anhu is very interesting, where he says, we came to meet Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and with him was his uncle Al-Abbas radiallahu anhu. And Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw the both of us and said to us that, do you know these two, O my uncle? And he said, yes, this is Al-Bara bin Ma'rur, who's a leader amongst his people, and this is Ka'ab bin Malik, the famous poet, a sha'ir. Ka'ab radiallahu anhu says, by Allah, I would never forget Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's statement in regards to me, where he knew me because of my poetry. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned to his uncle Abbas radiallahu anhu, this is Ka'ab bin Malik, a sha'ir. Anyway, in that, Bara radiallahu anhu posed his question like this, O Nabi of Allah, we have come on this journey, Allah has guided us to Islam, and I feel I do not want to face my back to the Kaaba. And I mentioned this to my satis, but they all disagreed. So, O Nabi of Allah, this is in my heart, what do you feel? And Allah's Nabi sallallahu, what do you instruct? Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, O Bara, Allah has given us a Qibla for now, لو صبرت عليها. Patiently remain in facing Baytul Muqaddas. So Bara radiallahu anhu then returned to facing Baytul Muqaddas. Aun bin Ayyub Ansari radiallahu anhu says in poetry, praising Bara radiallahu anhu, وَمِنَّ الْمُصَلِّي أَوَّلُ النَّاسِ مُقْبِلًا عَلَىٰ كَعْبَةِ الرَّحْمَانِ بَيْنَ الْمَشَاعِرِ. Amongst us is the first of the Ansar who already started facing the Qibla. And then it was Allah's will that not long after that, before Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam migrated to Medina Munawwara, this Sahabi Al-Bara bin Ma'rur radiallahu anhu had left this world already. So from the people of Medina Munawwara, from the Ansar of Medina Munawwara, the first Sahabi to leave this world was Al-Bara bin Ma'rur radiallahu anhu.
After that, just after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam migrated, another sahabi, Kulthum bin Hidm radiallahu anhu, he was among the first after the hijrah. This was the hijrah of the muhajireen, the first of the Ansar who had passed away. But from the muhajireen, the first of the sahaba to pass away from those who made hijrah in Medina Munawwara was Uthman bin Maz'un radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So we learn from the Sahaba radiallahu anhu how they prioritized the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah's order, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's deen comes first. And this is what every one of us need to learn. Look at Ayyash radiallahu anhu, and Umar radiallahu anhu, and Hisham radiallahu anhu, and Bara bin Ma'rur radiallahu anhum, how they prioritized the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There was this sahabi who was very young, Talha bin Bara radiallahu anhu. See the lesson Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught humanity. How Ayyash understood, how Umar radiallahu anhum understood that Allah comes first before everything else. This is what we need to understand. This young sahabi radiallahu anhu was very, very close to his parents. One report explains his closeness to his mother, another explains his attachment to his father. When he came to embrace Islam, he said, O Nabi of Allah, Murni bima ahbabt, you can tell me whatever you want to tell me. This is in one report. The next report says, he comes to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he says, O Nabi of Allah, give me your hands, I want to take the bay'ah and I want to bring iman. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to him, would you abide by any injunction? وَإِنْ أَمَرْتُكَ بِقَطِعَةِ وَالِدَتِكَ, even if I tell you to break ties with your parents, would you do so? In the one report, he says, I wouldn't be able to do that. Then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave him some time, and then afterwards, he said, O Nabi of Allah, one report says this was the third time, and he was so close to his mother. And Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, even if I tell you to break ties, would you abide? Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, he said, that O Nabi of Allah, of course I would abide. Then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, that there is no breaking ties in our deen, but I wanted you and humanity to understand that there must not be any doubt in our iman, and that deen and iman comes first. This is the one report. The other report says that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, would you obey any injunction I give you? He said, yes, O Nabi of Allah. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, go, faqtul abak, go kill your father and come. He goes straight towards that direction. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called him back and said that I wanted to test your iman, but actually in our deen there is no breaking of ties. فَإِنِّي لَمْ أُبْعَثْ بِقَطِيعَةِ رَحِيمٍ, I was not sent to break ties. So we learn from here that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the deen of Allah ta'ala comes first. Then the sahabi Talha radiallahu anhu becomes ill, and Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to visit him. يَعُودُهُ فِي الشِّتَاءِ, and it was cold weather and it was cloudy. Afterwards, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to his family, لا أرى طلحة إلا قد حدث فيه الموت, I feel strongly that my young sahabi is going to be leaving this world. As soon as he leaves this world, make sure you notify me. حتى أشهده وأصلي عليه, so that I can perform the janazah salah and make dua for him. And as this young sahabi was about to leave this world, he regained consciousness again. Because when Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, he was not conscious. He asked, anyone came? They said, Allah's Nabi came. He was so happy, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, did Allah's Nabi say anything? They mentioned to him certain things. Then he said to them, that I know I would be leaving this world, and when I die, this night is cold, I live far from Masjid al-Nabawi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Do not notify my Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I don't want it to be that he comes to my janazah and he comes here and some harm afflicts him, some animal attacks him, the Jewish people that live in this area might cause harm to him. Do not do that. I do not want to incur any harm upon my Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look at the consideration of this young sahabi, Talha bin Bara radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The next day when Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam inquired in regards to him, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was told that Talha had left this world already. Allah's Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said to them, why didn't you all notify me? They said, O Nabi of Allah, this was his wishes. Allah's Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam then went to his grave and made dua for him. And amongst the duas Allah's Nabi gave him, Allahumma alqahu wa huwa yadhaku ilayka wa anta tadhaku ilay. Oh my Allah, meet my young Talha in such a manner, in such a manner that he is smiling at you, and you are showing him love and kindness, and you are smiling at him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept us all for his deen. This is the love of sahaba radiyallahu anhum for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the deen of Allah ta'ala. So we learn in all these incidents of the sahaba radiyallahu anhum to make deen priority and to make the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam our objective. And everything else comes afterwards. And in deen there's rights. Our parents have rights. Family members have their rights. Our children have rights. We have to understand how to fulfill the rights of each, not falling short in anyone's huquq and rights. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to understand the beautiful lives of sahaba radiyallahu anhum, and may Allah enable us to share their beautiful lives to humanity. Allah help us to understand, to practice and to impart. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyil ummi bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin.